Last week, we learned about something that was on chromosomes numbers 1 through 13. And this week, we're going to finish up our journey along the 23 chromosomes. Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, where we help you understand your DNA, climb your family tree, and write your ancestor's story along the way. We had a fun time last week learning about the first 13 chromosomes, and today we're going to go over the next 10 chromosomes. And again, I want to emphasize that these are not the only traits or conditions that you find on each one of these chromosomes. There's lots of different things on each one of them, and in many cases, they all interact with other genes in order to create the different attributes that we have as humans. With that, let's get started. Now, who thought we would have the Prime Minister of Great Britain from World War II in our genome? Winston Churchill. This is where we get some of these funny things about genes. There's nothing about smoking cigars or being really eloquent that has to do with chromosome number 14. No, in fact, what it is it's a gene that's called the Churchill gene. And that is purely because it was named after the little victory sign that Churchill was famous in a photograph for making. The gene happens to be shaped, or that not the gene, but the protein that the gene is made from happens to be shaped like a V for victory. And I believe it was discovered back, you know, in the early 50s or 60s sometime. I'm not sure where. I'd have to look that up. But I'm sure that the person that discovered it probably had just read a book about Winston Churchill or had just seen that picture. And they needed to name this thing something. And so they named it the Churchill gene, which honestly is a lot better than a lot of the other gene names that they have, because a lot of the other gene names are basically the protein, specifically some scientific name, hard to remember. This one, Churchill gene, I have no idea what it does, but it looks like a V. Chromosome number 15. Now this one I'm leery to say because I think some people may take it the wrong way. Skin, hair, and eye pigmentation are not from a single gene. In fact, there is a multitude of genes that all work together that determine your skin, hair, eye color, and that's why we have this enormous diversity of colors that we see through people all around the world. But on chromosome number 15, there is a gene that helps in the processing of melanin and how that is expressed. Melanin is one of the proteins that give you your skin, hair, and eye color. And so this gene actually regulates how that is processed and so what is actually being presented out to the visual eye from that. But it is not the only gene that goes into this. So if you isolated this, you would not be able to tell what color of hair, skin, or eyes somebody has. And now that I've mentioned that about chromosome number 15, we're going to go to chromosome number 16, which I say red hair. This is the exact opposite. It is actually, there's a couple of genes, but you know, this is really just one gene that is in people who have red hair. And just like the ABO blood group, if you have this gene, if you have two copies of this gene, then you're going to have red hair. If you have one copy, then you're going to pass that down to your kids. In my family, I don't have any copies. My grandpa had two copies, and so my mom got a copy, but she didn't have two copies because she just had one copy. Each of my brothers got one of those copies, but I didn't get it, so my kids don't have a copy of that gene from my grandfather, which is why none of them have red hair. But if you do have red hair, then you got two copies of this gene on chromosome number 16. Chromosome number 17. Do you have dry skin? You might be able to blame chromosome number 17 and one of the genes on that. And this gene makes a protein which helps to regulate the moisture content on our skin, which when you combine that with the sweat gene from earlier, hey, these actually probably work together in tandem to do different things that involve sweating and our skin. But we go now to chromosome number 18. There's 23. We're still not done. We're almost there. Chromosome number 18. This is a really important one. There is a gene called the ATPA, I believe it's called, and it is involved in making the ATP protein, adenine triphosphate, or a protein related to adenine triphosphate. And for those non-biology majors out there, you probably have no clue what adenine triphosphate is, But for those of you with biology background, you know that that is one of the major components of cellular energy. And when I say cellular energy, I really mean energy for everything. So everything you do is involving energy, and it all goes down to the cellular level of this ATP being produced and broken down into other things, which leaves some energy. And that's, you know, all my shaking and going crazy and everything, talking, all of that is involving cellular energy. And so I have chromosome number 18 and the ATPA gene to thank for the fact that I can actually do anything, because I need that cellular energy, and you do too. And all of us have this gene that is producing this because we're doing something. 19, my kids like to say that, you know, puberty is a disease. Well, the regulation of puberty, the onset of puberty is regulated by a gene on chromosome number 19. There is a condition where if you have a defective gene here in this position, that you actually don't go through puberty, and you basically stay like a, you know, looking like a young child all throughout your life. If you're male, your voice doesn't deepen. You don't get that Adam's apple or anything. But also all the other things associated with puberty, whether you're male or female, just don't happen. And so this gene on number 19, well, if you've gone through puberty, then you have two good copies, or at least one good copy of this gene. Chromosome number 20, bonding. There is a hormone called oxytocin. And oxytocin is sometimes called the love hormone. It's actually a hormone that is used in to help childbirth, to begin childbirth. But it is also a hormone that we see in bonding between parent and child, between lovers. You know, kissing produces oxytocin going crazy in your brain. That's why it feels good, as well as other things. But, you know, if you think about, you know, if you're feeling good, if you're feeling happy, it might be this oxytocin. It might be chromosome number 20 that you can thank for creating that chemical in your body, which makes you feel good. Now, chromosome number 21 is actually one of my favorite, one of the most, you know, researched ones of this. And this is Down syndrome. And we did a video on trisomy and what that looks like. Down syndrome happens not when you have a defective gene, but when you have an extra copy of chromosome number 21. And because of the different genes on chromosome 21, it helps explain why there's the different features that you see on people that have Down syndrome. Now, Down syndrome is not the only trisomy condition. There's actually several other genes that may have that, but most of them end up killing the child before they were born in some cases, or very early on in life. And so Down syndrome is probably the most well-known one, because people who have Down syndrome still can live to adulthood and actually can live a normal human lifespan. Let's go on now to chromosome number 22. We're almost at the end. And chromosome number 22, there is a gene that codes for some of the proteins for making the lens of the eye. Now, when you remember, there was actually one for night vision several chromosomes before. And so you can see that you can't say, oh, well, chromosome X is, you know, for your vision. Well, no, there's different parts of your vision that are regulated by different chromosomes and different genes on those chromosomes. So the lens of your eye is actually from, or regulated or built from this gene on chromosome number 22. It's one of the ones that helps to build that. It's not the only one, but it's one of the major ones for that. And since we're talking about eyes, we're going to go on to chromosome number 23 and talk about color blindness. Again, something else with the eyes. So we've already talked about three different chromosomes that have something to do with our vision or our eye, and color blindness is one of them. Now, for those of you who are astute out there, you might be thinking, hey, isn't chromosome number 23 our sex chromosomes, the X and the Y? And you would be right. It is. And this is why this one is really an interesting one to look at. The gene for this is on the X chromosome. Now, men have one X and one Y. So if they have the defective gene in this area, they're going to be colorblind because they only have one X chromosome, whereas women, since they have two X chromosomes, as long as there's one good gene, they're probably not going to be colorblind. And we see this played out in the fact that about 8% of men have some form of colorblindness, and only about 0.5% of women have some form of colorblindness. With many of the other traits, it's actually pretty even between men and women as far as, you know, whether you have the recessive or, you know, these conditions. But with the sex-based characteristics, which colorblindness is one of them because it's on the sex chromosomes, we find that men usually have these conditions much more often than women, simply because we only have one X chromosome. So we only have one shot to get a good gene, and if we don't get that, we don't get that. That then is 23 chromosomes and 23 different traits or diseases that we see on each one of those chromosomes. Let me reiterate again, those are not the only things that are on that chromosome, and in many cases, that one gene is not the only thing that regulates that. However, there's a couple of exceptions like that ABO blood group, as well as the red hair, but many of them actually involve lots of genes. There's about 20 to 25,000 genes, depending on how they count them. I've seen different sources for that. But really, when you think about it, thousands of genes that all make up this amazing human that we have with our DNA. So I know that that really had nothing to do with genealogy, although some of the passing it down from mother and father to son and daughter, you might be able to think about that. But it was just a fun answer to a question that several people have asked about what is on each one of these chromosomes. What do those chromosomes mean? So if you've liked this, then be sure to give this a thumbs up. If you have any questions about what's on the chromosomes, then put it in the comments below and I'll try to answer it. And if you haven't joined as a member, be sure to join where you will have access to some extra live streams and webinars that are only available to our members. Click on the join button. It's only $2.99 a month.